Good evening, friends. On behalf of Legal Eagle Elites, we welcome each and every one of you who have joined in for today's special session on decoding all four labor codes by Senior Counsel Ravindran sir. I welcome sir on behalf of Legal Eagle Elites and all the participants. Today we have amongst us one more special guest, who is the Chairman of National Institute of Personnel Management, and wherein I am the Vice Chairman there. And sir is also the lead HR head. And it is proud privilege to welcome Ravindran sir and Raja sir, NIPM Chairman.
Thank you.
Let me take the opportunity to read out the profile of Ravindran sir. Every time when we read out the profile, it gives us immense satisfaction and also the strength in the mind of all the young lawyers to achieve a person who has reached this level from a simple beginning. Senior Counsel Ravindran sir is a designated senior counsel by the Madras High Court, and almost 40 years of his practice, he is specializing in labor and service law, and he represents management before the labor courts, industrial tribunals, and the High Court of Madras. And Ravindran sir has published e-book on case law on this domestic enquiry referring 676 judgments arranged in 32 chapters, which is forwarded by Honorable Justice F.M. Ibrahim Khalifullah sir, was a former judge of Supreme Court of India. And again, Ravindran sir has also authored a e-book titled The Contract Labor Regulation and Abolition Act 1970, containing full text of 67 important landmark judgments, along with barracks, rules, forms, and notifications, which again forward from Honorable Justice Mr. F.M. Ibrahim Khalifullah, former judge, Supreme Court of India. Mr. Ravindran sir is also the honorary president of Labor Law Practitioners Association of Chennai. His balanced view as on labor relation issues have been published in leading newspapers, including The Hindu, The Indian Express, and The Deccan Chronicle. People who would have read his article recently on the present topic, which he's going to deliberate in The Hindu. Many of you have joined in reading that article. You have messaged me as well. Few requested for a session. And also leading law journals like Labor Law Journal and Labor Law Notes, wherein he has published his articles. And Ravindran sir is an expert in labor relations, and the new code or the present codification of the labor laws is the in thing, and not only the labor practitioners, everyone from the HR are from people who are connected with this labor management relations is very much interested in knowing this today. Not only the advocates or the law students or the legal fraternity, we have honorable judges, the senior advocates, junior advocates, lawyers, and also HR persons from all over India. Today it's not only Tamil Nadu, we have from pan India, from north to south, east to west, so many have connected today, and it's my proud privilege to welcome you, sir. Before I give the dais to you, may I take the proud privilege of welcoming the Chairman of National Institute of Personnel Management, Chennai Chapter, Mr. Raja, who is also the head of Lead HR. I welcome you, sir, to felicitate Mr. Ravindran, sir, on behalf of your personal self and also on behalf of NIPM.
Thank you, and good evening, ladies and gentlemen. I'll give you
sir, assurance. Raja sir, unga light, unga face therila.
Oh, okay. 1 minute.
Yes, sir.
Is it better now?
Yes, sir. It's better.
There's a assumption.
You can start, friends. Sir. We can edit it while going for YouTube.
Friends, good evening, and it gives me a great pleasure in joining this meeting. First, my hearty congratulations to Adi Lakshmi Madam for doing a lot of webinars during the lockdown and even the post-lockdown on many interesting subjects, including the latest labor amendment, and also many other programs. Congratulations to you, Madam. And on behalf of myself and NIPM, gives me a great pleasure in felicitating senior advocate and our own member, none other than advocate Ravindran sir. Sir, good evening. It's a pleasure to see you once again here. Friends, you all, many of them must be aware, NIPM is one of the oldest HR forum in India. We have around 53 branches across the country, and Chennai is one of the oldest chapter. We have close to 12,000 members in all India, and the Chennai chapter has around 700 members, including our senior advocate and today's guest speaker, Mr. Ravindran Sir, is also one of our members. So one thing, you know, we always admire him with Ravi Sir is, whenever, you know, I have close to around 5-6 years interaction with Ravindran Sir. During my last tenure as a secretary with NIPM, where we conducted a national conference 2017, and subsequently last 2 years as a chairman of Madras chapter. Whenever I call him and ask for his date, he only say 1 minute. He will check his calendar and say, "Go ahead." That's a way he supports for our chapter activities. Even during lockdown, he has conducted 2 or 3 programs for us for the benefits of the HR fraternity. Whenever many of the friends, I used to talk to them, they never feel, they are talking to a senior counsel. They always feel that they are talking to a big brother. That's it. That's a kind of a comfortness he has, and he is always our favorite person whenever there is a conference or a workshop related to amendment and in the labor law side or even statutory side. So we're proud to have you, sir. And in fact, coming Monday we have a paid workshop where Ravindra Sir is going to take one major class for 3 hours. So with these few words, so God bless you, sir, Ravindran sir. So I'm also looking forward to have your session today. And my congratulations to Adi Lakshmi madam and all the team members of Legal Alliance. Thank you very much for this opportunity.
Thank you so much, sir, for your blessing. Thank you. And all credits first goes to my beloved father, who's an advocate and also a former chairman of NIPM. And he's the person who has introduced every one of you who have been here. Mr. Ravindran sir, I know even as a young girl, school going girl, and Raja sir, everyone. Thank you. I should thank my father for training me this way. And he is the person who's the advisor behind all these things. Maybe I'll request my father to join this session and he will be with us also. Thank you, Raja sir. Now the forum is open and the dais is open for today's guest speaker. May I now request respected senior advocate Ravindran sir to take over the dais today and to deliberate on today's topic on decoding of 4 labor codes. Welcome you, sir.
Good evening, everyone. My thanks to Mrs. Lakshmi and Mr. Raja for their generous praise on me, though I don't deserve everything. As Mrs. Lakshmi said, her father, Mr. Soundarajan, is an inspiration for all of us. No doubt, Mrs. Lakshmi is going in the right direction with an enormous spirit, which I must say. She is always with enthusiasm, whether I see the court or elsewhere, she is always with enthusiasm. And I owe a duty to legal fraternity as well as IR, HR, forums to share my knowledge whenever they want, undoubtedly. That has been my principle all these years. That's why I'm always available, subject to my timing, etc. I'm next to 1 hour and say about 30 minutes. I hope to dissect all these 4 labor codes one by one. I'll go methodically so that it is made interesting. I'll take IR code, then wages, then occupational safety, health and welfare, then end social security. In this 1 hour and say about 10 minutes is not able to, you feel confident after hearing me. I will highlight the legal issues concerned in this 4 codes. because I cannot go section by section. It's not possible. This each needs a separate workshop, not even a session workshop. I'll highlight in a chronological manner so that you will get a grasp of it. I'm sure Mrs. Lakshmi has sent you the PPT well in advance. When you find time, you can go through it and relate it with the text of the four quotes. A brief introduction to these quotes. The oldest labor enactment in the present form, not about the earlier forms and its names, the present form, is the Employee Compensation Act or erstwhile Workman Compensation Act 1923. I'm speaking about the major enactments. The next latest one from that angle is 1952 EPF Act. So thereafter, some laws have come. All these enactments, as you know, now it's almost a century old or about 70 years old. But there has not been much of a life injected into these enactments. No doubt here and there some amendments have taken place on the question of wages or ceiling or percentage of compensation, etc. Under the Industrial Disputes Act, certain amendments have been made in 50s, 65, lastly in 82. Thereafter, here and there, some amendments. Nothing has taken place. The reason is very obvious. Labor is a very sensitive subject. And politically, it's a very risky subject. And we don't have good labor ministers either in the central or state government to take it forward. It's a lackluster position. So we have not been getting much of an infusion of life into the labor enactments all these years. But no doubt the judiciary has taken a role in formulating the principles and also taking it forward. But the biggest lacuna in judicial decisions is its uncertainty, as you all know. It can be overruled, it can be reviewed, a larger bench, etc. So a lot of uncertainty is there. And it's also judge-centric. Okay, particular judge has got a view during his period, this will be the trend of the judgments. So another judge comes, it will be the trend. So there is a sort of an uncertainty. I do not know how far it is true that the investment of capital on industry, service, etc. depends on the labor laws. I'm not sure. But they say labor legislation play an important role apart from revenue enactments to decide an investment factor in our country. The companies, as far as I know and I advise, they want to comply with the law, no doubt about it. But they want to know what is the law. That, as simple as that. If you depend on judgments, you know, what's, for example, Vodafone case, they lost in Bombay, Supreme Court reversed it. Then a legislation was passed to overcome Supreme Court. Now recently in international arbitration, again they won. It's a classic case that not only foreign investor, even Indian entrepreneur wants to know what is the law. Unless it is codified, it won't be possible with certainty. No doubt certain interpretation is possible even thereafter. But that's only a side issue. In that manner, the labor codes were sought to be overhauled, not now, even earlier, twice. But because of those governments were short-lived, with 5 years, no second term, etc., all fell through. When this government brought this overhauling the last tenure itself, I was worried whether it will take place at all. But because they have come back to power for the second time, they were able to take it up further. So in 2019, it started. So it went to consultation, etc. Then it came back again. So now we got notified labor codes. It is called the accent of the president. It has also been gazetted. So a final product is there. Whenever there is a change, obviously there will be opposition. And anything which is brought new will not be satisfactory, especially when there are two divergent views. One is state versus public, that's okay. But here the stakeholders are capital and labor. So there will be definitely opposition to certain provisions on either side. It's inevitable. But this code, to start with, is a welcome one. undoubtedly. We need a lot of changes, and it has gone to that extent, not full extent, to great extent. To that extent, we must appreciate the legislature's intent. The courts have been classified very well. They have been classified very well, undoubtedly. To that extent, it's a very good beginning. Now, we will go to the courts one by one. First, I will take industry relations court. Industry relations court has rightly taken three enactments in its fold. That is Industrial Disputes Act, Trade Union Act, and Industrial Employment Standing Orders Act. What in nutshell these three enactments say and what this IR court says is very simple. They take care of the laws relating to employment, trade unions, and service conditions. This is good enough. This is what an individual workman or a group of workmen look to during their period of employment in respect of their service conditions since conciliation, settlement, adjudication. This is good. To start with, this is what. Now, let us quickly see one by one. I have about 100-odd slides. But I will take the core issues and then inform you. Let us take the first one. I'm a section called 2P, which is definition of industry. Why I'm referring to that in the beginning itself is the provisions of this enactment, this code, depends on what is an industry. So this code applies to industry as earlier under the Industrial Disputes Act. Now, the earlier definition was really outdated, even in 1978, when the Supreme Court, not interpreted, created a new law for the definition of industry. Now, Justice Krishnayyar made a simple but telling point as to what is meant by industry. He said there are what is called as a triple test, that is systematic activity, where there is employer-employee relationship, which results in goods and services being delivered to the public at large. If these three are happening, it is an industry. So he, in one stroke, he demolished the traditional view. There must be a factory, there must be a shop, there must be a business, there must be investment of capital, etc. Everything was demolished. Now, this definition has virtually borrowed that Supreme Court judgment. To the extent, it's a good beginning. But thoughtfully, they have excluded certain things which were included in the Supreme Court judgment. What they excluded is spiritual and religious nature of activities. They have excluded from their definition of industry. They have also excluded charitable, social, and philanthropic service and domestic service. But they made it clear these activities, triple test, they said, need not have a capital investment for that, or they need not have a motive of doing a business with a profit or gain. So whatever may be your objective, but if you do all those three activities, you are an industry, and to that extent of exclusion. So this clarifies the ground to begin with once and for all. So everything is an industry if you do the three activities, excluding what is said in the definition. Now, if it's the industry, there must be an industrial dispute. Because if you don't settle what results, is it a dispute? They have clarified very clearly, unlike the earlier enactment, industrial dispute includes an individual dispute and a collective dispute. You all know individual dispute means non-employment cases. Collective dispute, as you know in the earlier definition, in respect of employment, non-employment, terms of employment, condition of service in respect of the labor. So they combined both together and said, this is the industrial dispute. So the divergence is taken away. It's good. The time has come from what is said in 47 and 65 does not exist any longer. So industrial dispute definition is made very clear. The next incorporation is very crucial and it's also relevant. What is called as fixed term employment. Now, we all know historically people used to get up, if they get a job in a good company, traditionally, they get appointed and they also retire. Or they put long years of service, then they move to another company, etc. Therefore, the employment was normally taken appointment till retirement, that is 58 years as mentioned in the appointment order or in the standing orders. But after 1990s, when the economy, Indian economy opened up and the industry grew rapidly because of this restriction on licensing, etc., was taken away. And thereafter, in early part of this century, turn of this century, tremendous growth of service industry and IT industry opened up avenues for large-scale employment, undoubtedly. Therefore, this appointment till retirement days were also over. This is the positive aspect of it. The negative aspect of it is the competition became severe. The days of only Ambassador and Fiat are over. Now you have 50 cars at sedan level, entry level, small entry level sedans, then luxury, then SUV, then MUV, etc. You've got tremendous choice. And this results in death of many industries also, based on economic policy or changing technology or government policy, the industries also do not survive that many years. So the lifetime of an industry is also got reduced. For example, coal-based industries suffered a jolt because of the Supreme Court judgment on coal scrap. One of the biggest boiler manufacturing private industry in Trichy collapsed in no time because of the Supreme Court verdict. Therefore, the days of the company's future is also not very sure. So the days of long-term employment is over. The short-term employment is a reality. This is what I used to tell the courts also when I face a litigation of this nature. So it's the employers were clamoring for a flexibility. No doubt it was brought under 20BB of the earlier enactment, which provides for termination on the end of the contract period or termination based on a clause in the appointment order. But there was always a test whether it was a genuine contract or it's a malafide termination. But always you are on a test. This definition makes it very clear. If there is a fixed term employment, it will end. There is no further question on that. It is nothing but a simple common law principle of contract has been invoked in this. So after this end, if there is a termination comes to an end, there is no question of challenging it because it is taken away from the definition of retrenchment also once and for all. A question of motive or malafides does not arise at all. But only probably the caveat will be, you cannot continue me as a fixed term employee for many years. That may be looked upon as a not a two-spirit appointment. But if you can engage someone else, etc., that may not be questioned. But they have seen that the interest of the workman is also protected in this because that should not be left in the lurch. So they have said, but in fixed term employment also, the statutory benefits employed given to the permanent workman subject to the qualification should be the same. So employment is short term, but benefits, salary and other benefits are on par with the permanent workman. Therefore, there is no exploitation of labor on fixed term by fixing him at a minimum wage or etc. etc. So that twin objective is achieved in this provision. Employer to have flexibility and employee during that period has got a good statutory or contractual benefits and also payment of gratuity even if he works for 1 year. So that is taken care of in fixed term employment. Now, as I said, this retrenchment excludes fixed term employment. So now we got an industry and we also got an industrial dispute. Now we have to see who is a worker. There's no dramatic change in this definition compared to the earlier enactment. The core of the definition remains the same, but they have extended the increase the salary limit of a supervisor to 18,000 rupees. And importantly, if you see run throughout all the four courts, in most of the provisions, power has been given to the government to meddle with it or to change the applicability of the act in respect of salary limit or number of workmen. That is a good sign because every time we need not to be going for a legislative amendment, which does not take place so well. That's why now, even last few years, the government has the legislation made it clear for amendments of this nature, it need not come back to parliament. The government can do it. For example, bonus act, they already done it. So here also they said 18,000 at present, but the government can notify in amount. So this gives a flexibility to the government to notify the qualification based on the economic realities. If the wages increase tremendously next 10 years, this 18,000 will be a pittance. So they will probably increase it in. And importantly, they have brought in working journalists and also the sales promotion employees into the definition. Now, if there is an industry and there is a worker, there must be wages. This wages definition was a challenging one earlier. Different enactments were giving different definition, though to some extent in certain enactments like PF and gratuity, they were more or less same, but ESA was different. So this definition of wages was also not very clear on interpretation. For example, EPF Act, to know what is basic wages, we have struggled from 1963 to 2019 until the Supreme Court gave its judgment. No doubt in 2009, there was a judgment on Manipal Academy to say universally paid these wages. To know this concept, it has taken us 1956 to this date. There is a tendency to include various components in allowances so that basic is less, no payment of DA at all. So all these things drew the attention of the executive, where they say it's an act of subterfuge, we will treat everything as wages. So all those confusions were there. Now this definition is almost similar in all the four courts. The simple way of looking at definition, they have made it very simple here, is 50% of the pay packet should be basic DA and retaining allowance. The remaining can be whatever allowances you may call. So 50% of the basic DA retaining allowance, 50% of the allowances. Allowances are excluded from the definition of wages. Now, if you have more than 50% of the allowances, the whatever is excess of 50% will go into the inclusion portion. So it's very made clear. 50% of basic DA retaining allowance you must give. Even if you pick it at lesser amount, the allowances will jump into that. So 50-50, a very satisfactory way of resolving this legal conflict once and for all. If there is a labor, then there must be strike and there must be law code. So the good thing about this wage code is they remove the distinction of publicity service and a non-publicity service. They treated everything as an industry, everything as a service. So which is a publicity service? There's a lot of confusion on that. If a notification is given, for example, automobile manufacturing industry, whether it's spare parts or car making, there was an interpretation that late length. For example, food making industry, would a canteen come under this definition as a publicity service? If you make chocolate, does it come under the food processing industry? So what is a publicity service itself was a controversy. No, there need not be a publicity service at all in this industry definition now. Everything is an industry, everything is a service. Now, if you want to go on a strike, mandatory 14 days is a must. Then 6 weeks has been outer limit has increased to 60 days. And the strike during conciliation period is illegal. Similarly, whatever I say applies to the law court also. So strikes and law courts have been made difficult to be legal, both. So you cannot go on a strike, whatever may be your industry, without giving 14 days notice and up to 60 days. Then conciliation starts. During conciliation, you cannot go on a strike. Then if there is an adjudication, during adjudication also you cannot go on strike. Now, the definition of strike has also been slightly twisted. Now, you know, there are various forms of strike. It may not be really a declared strike, but inner agenda will be the strike. One method of inner agenda of strike is where the mass casual leave. Maybe for reasons genuine, but maybe extraneous to the industry. For example, one particular trade union says we will give a all India strike on economic policy of the government. What does it matter for my industry? Why should they go on a strike with regard to a larger issue, which is we are unconnected, but they used to go on a strike. But if they do not want to go on a strike, the best thing they can do is ask all their members to take a casual leave. So this has plugged that loophole. Now it has said the definition of strike includes casual leave on a given day by 50% or more workers employed in industry. So mass casual leaves will also be now treated as a strike. To the extent it makes clear that you cannot go on what is popularly called as wildcat strike or pin down strike or sudden strike or hidden strike, etc. Now, strikes have also been made difficult. To that extent, the lockout is also made difficult. So strikes and lockout is now over. Now we all know there is one provision in the earlier enactment called 9A, which is now section 40C, where you cannot change the service conditions of the employees unilaterally to their disadvantage in respect of matters scheduled in the Industrial Disputes Act. The same provision is listed here also as section 40. It also says in respect of third schedule, you have to give notice. Same hindrance is there here also. They have not reduced it in any manner. Only one exception they made is such a notice is not required if it is a case of emergent situation requiring change of shift or shift working in terms of the standing orders and in consultation with the grievance redressal committee. That's all, consultation. So in respect of shift, because of emergency situation, change to effect changes if it is required, or changes made in terms of a settlement or an award. It is very unlikely. So the government has been given some powers to change the change the service conditions without notice. Now, the another important principle in this new code is this conciliation process. Legally, there was a lot of issue as to when the conciliation starts and when it ends. When does the conciliation start and when it ends? Whether the very first meeting is a conciliation or a proper notice has to be given. Because if you see the earlier enactment, the definition of conciliation said any proceedings. But the rule said the conciliation officer should give a specific notice to that. Two division benches of Madras High Court have said every meeting before the conciliation officer is not conciliation. But another division bench said every meeting is a conciliation, it's gone to a larger bench. Why this relevancy of conciliation is, if there is a conciliation, as I said earlier, strike is prohibited. If there is a conciliation, you cannot terminate an employee in respect of a subject matter not connected without approval. But if it's connected with the dispute, we have to seek permission. So a lot of hindrance is there or control is there when the conciliation is pending before the conciliation officer. Now, they have made it very clear in this code, any meeting before the conciliation officer is conciliation. So very first meeting is itself is a conciliation. Once conciliation is there, you cannot declare lockout or go on a strike. You cannot terminate unilaterally. So that's it. When it ends, earlier it was not clear. Because conciliation ends under section 19 of the earlier act only when the conciliation report goes to the government, reaches the government. We do not know when the government receives it. So there was always worried when the conciliation will come to an end. Now they have said here the conciliation will come to an end the moment the failure is made. So we now have a clear idea when the conciliation takes place and when the conciliation ends. Now if the conciliation takes place, now, it is mandatory, no doubt, here also mandatory, but the weight of the what is relevant is, a conciliation is a must, but conciliation cannot go endless. There's an outer limit. Number two. Someone is speaking, you should mute. And number two, earlier, as you all know, conciliation should be referred by the government for adjudication. So if a dispute is taken, if there's no settlement in respect of larger issues, government reference is a must. In respect of non-employment, no reference, you can go to the court directly. Now, they have made it very simple. The conciliation ends, then the matter can go to the court straight away. Therefore, in respect of bonus dispute or charter dispute, demands issue or promotion, etc., etc., hereafter, there will be large number of disputes before the tribunals because of the shackles have been received. In one way, the positive is why should government hold the dispute by not referring, because when a dispute is raised, it should be resolved or it should go to adjudication. There is no business of in between where there is no result at all. So looked at from that view, it's good. Looked at the lot of frivolous being disputes being raised, it's not good. So that is the reality now. Now, so strike and lockout, conciliation, adjudication also we have seen. Now let's take one more important provision, which is the bone of contention between the employer and the employee. Before 1982, the employers had a right to lay off, retrench workmen and close the industry, subject to the compensation, etc. No doubt in 1976, an attempt was made by bringing in Chapter 5B, putting fetters on these three issues, saying the government must be approached for permission. There was struck down. 82, it was again enacted with the reasons which are given by the court being looked into and taken care of. That 82 amendment was upheld by the Supreme Court. Therefore, if you have 100 or more workmen working in your industry on any preceding day on the last 12 months, you cannot lay off, retrench your workmen or close the industry without the permission of the government. That was a lot of controversy why you should be there, why I cannot have the freedom to make my manpower planning as per my business scenario, etc. On the other hand, workmen saying this will prevent large-scale non-employment. That is one of the reasons why Supreme Court upheld it. Because in the 80s and all, there were large-scale unemployment. Therefore, they said there cannot be a fundamental right. There must be some factors, and these factors are reasonable. Now, they increased it to 100 to 300. So, an industry which is having less than 300 workmen on an average working day in the preceding 12 months need not obtain permission from the government to lay off and retrench its workmen or close its industry. But here again, the government has been given power to increase the strength from 300 to whatever is. So some leverage in favor of the management to that extent. Now, another change which has been made in this code is all the labor codes are being dismantled, and in its place, the tribunals come into force. So only the name change, but all the issues will be now hereafter only before one tribunal. Not a scheduled two or three, which says labor code, what are the issues, tribunal, what are the issues, national tribunal, etc. So now there is only one tribunal. No doubt national tribunal is there still. This tribunal will take care of all the labor issues in respect of single employee or large scale non-employment issues or large scale industrial and dust matters. So a single tribunal. And they also formed a bench. If there is a necessity, the government can notify a bench to deal with the larger disputes or the disputes which needs an administrative person with a specialized knowledge. That I think will be very rare, may not be a regular feature. And they also said in the event of any split in the bench, it will go to a third person who will be a judicial member, and that will be the verdict. Majority will be the verdict. So some change in the method of adjudication process have taken place. Now, one important point is, you all know when a person is terminated from service, he has to conduct the case during the period of non-employment. No doubt in the High Court, if he succeeds, the High Court will grant him some relief, but not in the lower court. Now, they introduced a provision saying, even before the industrial tribunal, if the non-employment issues are adjudicated before the tribunal, then the workman can be granted interim relief, a monetary relief by the tribunal based on its discretion. What would be the interim relief? Is it lost on wages or 50% of the wages? Whatever it is, it depends on the discretion of the tribunal, and also what is the factual aspect of it. There are a lot of parameters even given by the Supreme Court on this. Probably we can enforce those parameters by way of a defense in this interim relief. Now, the another power given to the government in the present code is that the government can even reject or modify the award of an industrial tribunal. It's very unusual where a judicial decision is being modified or rejected by an executive. The earlier provision 17 capital A was in fact struck down by the Madras Division Bench as being unconstitutional, but again they brought it here. I don't know whether it will be valid in law. Now another provision is there is a formation of workers reskilling fund. When you terminate an employee, apart from the legal dues payable to the employee, you have to donate, contribute 15 days last drawn salary to the fund, which will be supposed to reskill the dismissed employees for their future employment. That seems to be the scheme. How far it will function in the useful, we have to wait and see. Now, another thing is, whatever is the subject matter of this code, only industrial tribunals will deal with it, and civil courts have no jurisdiction. There was some legal issue on this, what is, where it starts, where it ends, what is an industrial dispute, what is the common law. The judgment of the Supreme Court was there on premier automobiles. They laid down four principles. How to interpret that four principles, what itself was a lot of litigation. Now they clarified, whatever is subject matter of the court, no other jurisdiction. Now, in the schedule of unfair labor practice, they included willful go slow as one of the unfair labor practice for the workman. Now, these are the basic issues on the industrial relations scenario. Now, we'll go to the next enactment, which is S12 Trade Union Act, one of the oldest, 1926. There has been no progress in this enactment all these years. It is not that the employer withheld any progress. It is the employees also, the unions also contributed for the static nature. One of the most important lacuna in this enactment was the recognition of trade unions. The trade unions are in this country for more than a century. That MLU, Madras Labour Union, is one of the oldest trade unions in the country. There is no law on recognition except some state enactment like Maharashtra, MRTU, Palpak, some Kerala, West Bengal. No central enactment, or in many states there is no recognition law. So it led to a lot of strife. One of the reasons for sudden strife in any industry is where the workmen join a union and the management does not recognize them. That leads to immediate flashback. It leads to definitely a strike or industrial unrest. It leading to non-employment, etc., etc. Majority union not recognized, minority union recognized, or minority union holding the majority union to ransom, or minority union holding the industry to ransom. So everything was in a confusing state of affairs. Now this legislation has taken care of it on two aspects. One, they said registration. No doubt seven can form a union registry, but for its continuation, that union must have, if you want to continue the registration, a membership of 10% or 100 workmen, whichever is less. So a registration can be continued only if you have a minimum strength. Therefore, you cannot have letter pad unions hereafter. There should be union with workmen's backing. The next one is most important. They have formulated what is called negotiating union or negotiating council. Both are one and the same. They said if there is only one union in an industry, it must be recognized. If there is more than one union, then a union which has got 51% and above strength must be recognized. But if there are more than one union, but none of them have 51%, at least the unions which have 20% strength must be recognized. So single union, 51%, 20%. And this recognition will be valid for 3 years and up to 5 years subject to consent by both parties. So this is a good sign. There is a union formation, there is a union registration, there is union recognition. So I hope this will lead to an industrial peace, at least on this front. Now, if there is a dispute among the unions, etc., this is also should be resolved only in terms of this court. They cannot rush to the civil court to resolve it, etc. So there is also a provision on that. So trade union issue is concerned, these are the two important points. Now standing orders, third enactment was standing order. They said that 300 or more workmen standing orders will be applicable, but in respect of existing companies, it will remain the same. So only in future companies, the code will have some important impact. I don't know why the strength is fixed at 300, it's a huge number. It could have been less than 300, like the present 20 or 50, but the present standing orders will remain. And the employer have an option to keep the model standing orders, which is available under the code. And the draft standing order should be completed within 60 days as presented by the employer. If it is not done, whatever he has presented is deemed to have been accepted and amended by the authority. So some in standing orders, some useful tinkering has been done. And standing orders will have an important role to play. Now, finally, what is that industrial codes do? In a nutshell, the highlights are fixed term employment, strikes and locks made stringent, wages definition has been clarified, recognition of trade unions have been given, power of the government in industrial strife by of a reference is taken away. Civil court jurisdiction is ousted. Interim leave is given to the workman during the period of his non-employment in an adjudication process. The threshold strength of industry to seek permission is increased from 100 to 300, and a division bench of tribunals have been formed. And more importantly, a lot of executive powers have been given in respect of applicability of the act by way of a notification, etc. One point which I have to highlight is the definition of layoff is still outdated. It says in the event of power failure or catastrophic or floods or shortage of raw materials, excess of stock, etc., can be laid off. These reasons are outdated now. Due to business reasons, we should be allowed to lay off, but it's found wanting. This power to go to the of the government to give permission is again not satisfactory. Increasing from 100 to 300 is not an issue at all. But this government is nowhere in India, the government is giving permission to lay off, retrench, or close the industry. But therefore, the permission decision should have been given to the industrial tribunal rather. A judicial forum will be better equipped to give a decision on these matters instead of government organizations, authorities who are seldom giving power. Similarly, this restriction on the management to change the service conditions is hampering the government's, the industry's flexibility to great extent. So these things have not been done in the present court, but the important points have been addressed in respect of industry, industrial dispute, conciliation, strikes, etc. have been done. To the extent this IR code is satisfactorily done, though not 100% in the interest of both parties. Next, we'll go to a minor subject called code on wages. This is the earliest one among these four. It is 2019 itself. It has been brought into force, notified also. Now rules have also been formed. Now this enactment takes care of consumes Payment of Wages Act, Minimum Wages Act, Bonus Act, and Equal Remuneration Act. Nothing significant in Payment of Wages, Bonus, and Equal Remuneration Act, but significance is in Minimum Wages Act, which will touch immediately. Now the definition of contract labor includes migrant workmen. This is very crucial in respect of wages, minimum wages, bonus, and equal remuneration. These migrant workmen now come into focus because the contract workmen are entitled for all these things, but migrant workmen are outside. So significantly, probably the government felt migrant workmen are being exploited without legal protection. They included them in the definition of contract labor. Now another important point is same work or work of similar nature has been defined. Now where the work is having the same skill, effort, experience, and responsibility among the sex, there cannot be a discrimination, same wages to be paid. Traditionally, women employees in a lot of jobs are paid less. On the ground of saying skill, etc., is different, but this flex a loophole. So on gender discrimination, apart from employment, even the terms of employment are protected in this. Code, important relevant provision in this code, which is called floor level wages or minimum wages. Floor level wages, as you all know, it is not legally binding, but it's a guideline to all the state governments not to fix wages less than this. Minimum wages should not be less than that. So the government was across the country was announcing floor wages. Now there has been modification in that. Now floor level wages or should be based on living standards, based on geographical area. So what is the floor wages in Assam cannot be the floor level wages in Maharashtra. It is entirely different. So a lot of good flexibility has brought in. And they said the floor level wages to take care of menus, food, clothing, and housing. Wages cannot be a stock. Now, next is important is minimum wages. It's been always a cry that this minimum wages itself is not minimum wages, but it is less than minimum wages. Or they used to critically say this is starvation wages. Now, in 1992, Supreme Court also took note of it and said the basket which contains the minimum wages is simply outdated. It cannot be so less hereafter. The Supreme Court clarified it should take care of certain other benefits like children education, old age pension, medical. These should be included pro rata, and minimum wages should be fixed. But nothing was done. So in this court, that has been addressed. It's a welcome sign. Now in this also, they are going to fix minimum wages based on skill and arduous nature of work. For example, in general engineering fabrication, skilled, unskilled, technical, unskilled, semi-skilled, That is on which the daily wages are fixed. They are set based on skill and arduous nature of work, minimum wages should be fixed. And it should not be less than floor hour wages, obviously. But they are also said, while fixing minimum wages, you should also fix a normal working day. It cannot be 8 hours, 9 hours, 10 hours. Therefore, they said this wages is for 8 hours work or whatever work thing. Beyond that, it goes automatically, it becomes a overtime wages. So a lot of protection is given on minimum wages. Then criteria for minimum wage is very good. They said it should take care of spouse and two children. A net intake of 2,700 calories per day as a consumption unit per adult. Then 66 meters of cloth per year for standard working class family. Then house rent expenditure of 10% of the food and clothing expenditure. Fuel, electricity, miscellaneous items expenditure to constitute 20% of the minimum wages. Children education, medical requirement, recreation, and expenditure on contingency at 25% of the minimum wages. Criteria recommended by Raftegas Bread as to great extent has been extended. So it is likely that hereafter the minimum wages will be more, which according to the judicial decision is a correct one. We should not say more. Minimum wages is never more. It is only minimum. But the criteria was less. Now the criteria has been refixed. So this is a good way to look forward in respect of minimum wages. There's not much of a change in bonus. There are only minor changes. I have nothing to say about all these things. Now the highlights of this statute is only three. Interstate migrant workman has been brought on this scope. So in respect of the wages, minimum wages, bonus, equal remuneration is taken care of. And work of similar nature as equal pay for equal principle has been approved in this, and fixed minimum wages has been given an upward trend based on the Supreme Court. These are the important highlights of this wage code. Now we will come to the next important code called Occupational Safety, Health and Working Conditions Code. This enactment has taken care of this code, has repealed not one or two, but 13 earlier enactments. I'll just read it out quickly so you will know the importance of it. Factories Act, Plantation Labor Act, Mines Act, Working Journalist Act, Working Journalist Fixation of Wages Act, Motor Transport Workers Act, BD and Cigar Workers, Contract Labor, Sales Promotion Employee, Interstate Migrant Workman, City Worker, Dock Workers, Building and Other Construction Workers. So majority of employment related acts have been codified into industrial occupation safety, health and working conditions. Important acts are no doubt Factories Act, then contract labor, migrant workman, and also the other enactments in respect of employment specific like BD, cigar, construction, plantation, etc. Now the factory definition of factory has been slightly changed. It is no more 10 and 20. 20 without power, 40, 20 without the power, 20 with power and 40 without power instead of 10 and 20. They also said that the government can increase the strength, whatever they will. But in respect of existing industry, it will remain the same. So new industries only, this 20-40 principle will apply. Now, contract labor definition also be here also, they have been modified. That definition includes interstate migrant worker. So there is no interstate migrant workman hereafter. In the sense, they come under the definition of contract labor. Though the terminology is used, there is no separate enactment for them hereafter. So they are on par with contract labor in all respects, including the registration, license, etc. Apart from protection of minimum wages, etc., they also entail for the benefits which were already provided under the interstate workman, that allowances, traveling, etc. Now the definition of contractor has also been expanded. even a person, not merely supplying labor, who gives a result in an industry is also brought within the definition of contractor, which is popularly or commercially called as works contract or service contract. They also now come under the definition of contractor. Now the applicability of the act has also been modified. It says 50 or more labor should be there, and the government can also increase its strength in the based on the necessity. But it is not applicable to industry which is intermittent or casual in nature, which is already there in the earlier. Now, as far as the license is concerned, though even in the earlier code, which should relate to work, there was a permissible allowance to certain vagueness, helper or cleaning, etc. But now this provision makes it very clear, the license of a contractor labor should be work-specific license. So it should be very specific for which the work is given, because they said if a license is applicable not for work specific, there is likelihood of misuse it. They're trying to plug that unsatisfactory provision in the present enactment. Now, interstate migrant workman is also taken care of. As per the existing law, a person is called an interstate migrant only when he is employed through an agent in one state by the employer in another state by of a contract, and that agent supplies him. So that in practice that does not take place. The so-called agent comes with the workman and he hands over to the local contractor, and they come under the Contract Labor Act, or they are not shown in the registration of stuff. Now they have made it very simple now. Whenever a worker from other state is employed, even directly by the company or through agent or through another senior worker, they are all interstate migrant. So interstate migrant workman is definitely simplified. They align with contract labor with all benefits, etc. So this act takes care of the interstate migrant workman welfare very much. Now the definition of occupier, there is a slight modification. Independent director cannot be an occupier hereafter. Now, two important provisions is, one is called a serious bodily injury. You all know under the Employee Compensation Act, where there is permanent disability or partial disability, etc. They include one more thing called serious bodily injury. The impact I'll show you very soon. Serious bodily injury means an injury involving permanent loss of any part of a body, including permanent loss of sight or hearing, or any permanent disability while working in an establishment. Now, if an employee apprehends there is likelihood of bodily injury to him while working in the factory, he can report to the inspector, who are now called as inspector cum facilitator, by of a complaint. Now, hereafter, hitherto it was not possible. Only a union can do. Even an individual employee gives, it was not being looked into. Now he has been given a liberty to tell the employer first or to the safety committee thereafter. If nothing happens, he can give a complaint to the inspector cum facilitator, who will take action immediately on this. Now, another important factor is, if a person is taken to task, that is the employer, is prosecuted for causing serious bodily injury to an employee, or the action causes death, during the case of trial before a magistrate court, when the magistrate imposes fine, now in the present code the fines have been increased very much, 50% of the fine amount, not the compensation before the authorities, 50% of the fine amount can be granted by the criminal court to the bodily injured employee, or in the case of death, to the legal heirs of the deceased employee. So out of the fine amount, amounts can be given to the concerned person or his family members. Now, in respect of contract labor, certainly one important definition which has been done is called as core activity. Now, they have said core activity is there, and in respect of core activity, there cannot be a contract labor. Now, what is core activity? They are defined under the code saying an activity which is essential or necessary to such activity. So in respect of a core activity, which is an activity which is essential or necessity for running of the establishment, is called core activity. And in such core activity, you cannot engage contract labor at all. But they excluded certain things. What is not termed as essential or necessity is the following activities. Establishments which are not set up for the activities, they are said now. One, sanitation work goes out. Watch and ward, again excluded. Canteen and catering, loading and unloading, running hospitals, courier service, civil and construction work, gardening, housekeeping, transport, or any intermittent nature. So even if these works are carried on, this cannot be termed as essential or necessity to such activity. Therefore, it will not amount to a core activity. In respect of other activities also, there are certain exclusions. Even if you do an admitted core activity, the exception is if the normal functioning of an establishment is such that the activity ordinarily is run through a contractor, it is excluded from the core activity. Though it is a per se a core, it is excluded. If the activity does not require full-time workers for long hours, though it may be essential work, still it is a core activity, still you can have contract labor. Sudden increase in volume of work in the core activity needing accomplishment of specified time. So these three activities, even among the core activities, can be excluded. So core activity is defined. In core activities, you cannot engage contract labor. What is core activity is based on the definition called as essential or necessity. If even among that, exclusions are given. Even if you come under the inclusion, three exclusions are given. So totally about 14 exclusions have been given from the core activity. So this is a good sign that we are moving towards the right direction. One, giving welfare to the workman. There is no exploitation of contract labor. But at the same time, protecting the interests of the industry. So this is take care of that aspect. It's an important issue in contract labor. Now the first time I'm coming across an act which says there should be an appointment order given to worker, then duties of the employees have been prescribed in this enactment. For example, it takes the duties of the employees include reasonable care of his health and safety and other persons complying with safety standards, etc. So he cannot be a careless worker. He should be a employee with duty in mind. So that has also been prescribed. Now in respect of hazardous process, the employer has been given right to the complaint to the facilitator directly. Then hours of the work have been fixed at 8. Very importantly, with the liberty to the government to fix it at a higher level. Then overtime is concerned, it can be done only with the consent of the worker and not without his consent. And it cannot be treated as a misconduct. But government has been allowed to prescribe total hours of overtime based on the notification. Then leave wages. The criteria, minimum criteria of number of workmen to obtain earned leave for the next succeeding year is reduced from 240 to 180. And women workmen have been given liberty to work even during night shift, any type of work, but subject to their safety in respect of their health and working conditions. Now, the next point is, what are the highlights of this code? First, duties of the employees have been prescribed. Overtime can be done only with the consent of a worker. Then increase the threshold strength of workers for the upper level 20 and 40. Core activity for the contract labor has been introduced. These are the four important highlights of this third code. Now I'll come to the fourth code. Now I'll come to the next code. Social security is a very important direction has been given in this code. This enactment takes care of 9 enactments. I'll read it out. Employee compensation, very important. Employee insurance, ESI. Then EPF, three most important enactments. Then employment exchange, then maternity benefit, payment of gratuity, senior workers' welfare, building and other construction workers' welfare, unorganized workers' security. So these are the 9 enactments which have been codified. So important thing is employee compensation, ESA, EPF. I'll go through that one by one. Now, as far as the employee injury is concerned, there's a lot of litigation on the fundamental principle, which is called employee compensation penalty be granted only if the accident takes place during the course of employment and out of employment. So during the course of employment means you should be performing work. You should be in the spell of employment. That is a contrariety. When does it stop? When it ends? The Supreme Court gave a principle called notional extension theory. Even if he starts from home, in certain circumstances, it will be treated as employment. Even after he leaves the office, goes to the home, it will be treated as an employment, certain spheres. Or for example, salesperson, he travels, it is treated as a driver. During long hours of driving, if he takes rest and suffers an accident, they also... But this enactment makes it clear once and for all, everything is an employment injury. Therefore, they said, employment injury includes accident occurring or occupational disease or contract, even outside the India. So first principle is even outside the India, this station has an employment injury. Then accident is presumed, just take care of all this country. Accident is presumed to have arisen in the course of employment only in the absence of evidence to the contrary. So if there is no contra evidence, it is treated as an employment injury. So yeah, outside, it's an employment injury. And everything is an employment injury if it takes place during the course of his employment. There is no starting bar, unless you give evidence to the contrary. Now, the most important aspect is, after 1990s, the economy started expanded. At least in 10 years' time, the service industry has gone phenomenally. To that extent, today the employment opportunity is mostly in service industry. Many people will come to our home every day, which was unthinkable few years ago, or employees. But there is always a subtle difference in employment law, which is known as engagement and employment. They said every contract is not an employment, or every engagement is not an employment. For example, a person who comes on a courier service to us, or this taxi service, who owns a car, but he has to be connected with the IT platform company to get his customers, and also the food supplier. The food supply worker, he gets an order on phone, he goes to the shop and delivers. He does not meet the employee at all. There is no employer-employee in strict sense. So these workers are all called as gig workers. I didn't know this terminology until I read this code. They are defined as gig worker, means a person who performs work arrangement and earns from such activity outside traditional employer-employee relationship. So they have brought in gig workers into the scheme. I'll tell you why, what is the importance of it. Next is called as platform workers. Whoever organized this program, administrator or a technician, etc., they are all, it's called a platform worker. Platform work means arrangement outside a traditional employer relationship by using online platform. So this is a tremendous growth of industry, back office, etc. Then platform worker is defined. Platform worker means a person engaged in platform work. Now, then there is another provision called unorganized workers. So this Social Security Code takes care of unorganized workers, gig workers, and platform workers, and gives them various social security benefits, including ESI and product. This is most important. Apart from this, the central government is going to form a social security fund for these unorganized workers, platform workers, and gig workers to take care of their social security and welfare of them. Then there is also a social security scheme which will take care of gig workers and platform workers relating to disability, maternity, old age, with funds funded by the central government and state government, or from aggregators, or from corporate social responsibility fund within the meaning of Companies Act. So there is to be social security fund, and also there is going to be social security scheme for all these loosely called as employees, but they're all very informal employees, which is called as untraditional persons, untraditional workers. So this enactment takes care of it. Now, as far as the ESA is concerned, or stringent amendment, a stringent provision has been brought in, class 42. If they don't pay contribution, ESA contribution, the ESA corporation is still bound to fulfill their obligations, because the definition says payable contribution payable, even if a default in payment account, unlike PF. Unless you make payment, you won't get the contribution. But in ESA, even if you don't pay, he is entitled for benefits. Now the corporation has been entitled to give benefit to an employee for whom the employer has not made contribution for a particular month or some month or not at all included him under the contribution bracket. The corporation will give him all the benefits in case of hospitalization, accident means compensation, monthly payment, etc. And very importantly, they will not only claim the contribution from you, but they will also claim what is called as capitalized value of the benefits paid to the deceased employee or accidental employee who suffered because of non-payment of contribution. So if you don't make contribution, you should be ready to pay much more than that. That is the expenditure made by the ESA corporation towards this, that they will claim and require it from you as a land revenue. There is a controversy on that. It will be resolved, but you will be facing the music for non-payment of contribution. And second most important thing is, if the working conditions are not in good environment, that is, they called as insanitary working conditions. There is insanitary working condition in industry, which results in a large scale sickness to the employees, insured persons. The corporation will claim expenditure, extra expenditure on that from the employer. So this is another important provision. So you must pay the contribution, and you also should keep sanitary conditions. If unsanitary condition results in large scale sickness, you are liable to pay the compensation for that. Now this is two very important provisions under the ESA aspect is concerned. And in respect of hazardous process, even if there is a single employee, the provisions of ESA Act has been made applicable. In respect of gratuity, in respect of fixed term employment is concerned, even for 1 year of service is entitled for gratuity, and there is no question of 5 years of continuous service. And in respect of fraud and fund, the earlier provisions remain, but similar to ESA Act, PF Act also, the limitation period of 5 years has been fixed. It's a very welcome one, because they need not, we are not liable to pay for old arrears. So period of limitation has been fixed as 5 years, similar to the ESA Act. And the if you file an appeal before the tribunal in respect of PF, you have to deposit 70%, whereas in the ESA it is 50%. Now they made it 25%. So if you lose a case, which is normally happens certain times on the higher side, though not realistically, 25% is sufficient to make the payment, get an appeal done. Now, as far as the highlights are concerned in this code, inclusion of non-traditional workers called as gig workers and platform workers brought under social security. It should take care of their welfare to great extent. Then levy of capitalized value of collection from the employer for non-payment of contribution. Then extra expenditure recovery from the employer due to insanitary working conditions. Gratuity fixed for the fixed term employees even if they don't work for 5 years. Then 5 years limitation for EPF demand. So these are the four codes. You take all the four codes in a nutshell, if you see, as far as the IR code is concerned, trade union recognition has been done. Then fixed term employment has been brought in. Strikes and lockout have been made difficult. Then individual worker have been granted interim relief during this non-employment. As far as code on wages is concerned, except minimum wages, there nothing, but minimum wages fixation, significant changes have been made. As far as occupation safety, health, and other working conditions are concerned, practice act rules have been tightened, contract labor rules have been tightened, poor activity has been defined, and overtime has been made stringent. And these provisions will go a long way to take care of the interests of the workman and make industry responsible. Social security, as just now I said, a lot of unorganized workers have been brought under the social security. So to end, as I said in my article in the newspaper, this is a good beginning. still there are certain things to be done. That beginning has been made itself is historic, I said. That itself is historic. After 1923, enactment is amended, or overall. After 1926, another enactment. 46, 52, 56, most of the major enactments. Fact is that ID Act, ESA, PF, employee compensation, if you take, these are the core acts. Significant changes have been taken place. But there is an element of disappointment for the employer as well as the employee on certain aspects when that is involved. Because labor, we cannot go on a whole hog. But is it landmark or game changer, as they claim? I don't think so. It may not be a game changer or landmark. It should not be, rather. It should not be. Because you cannot have such a game-changing or landmark pro-labor amendments, nor there can be a crucification. For example, take today's newspaper. Because of corona pandemic, certain state governments made significant amendment in certain portions of the act. We should also know why this state governments are able to do. In constitution, there are three schedules. The many schedules, the three schedules are the power of the central government to enact laws, power of the state government to enact law, and power of both the governments to enact law, which is called as central code, the state code, and also the common code. Under the common code, both state as well as central can enact laws. That's why you'll find state enact shops act, etc. This Gujarat government said, hereafter overtime for more than 11 hours per day, then dramatically they changed it. Now Supreme Court has struck it down. So you cannot have a landmark or a historic or a game changer things in labor and economy. You have to go slowly but steadily. But that has taken place. So I am rather satisfied with this four codes to great extent. And no doubt interpretation of certain laws will lead to future litigation, but that will be less. In my view, it has been rather simplified and settled. Many controversial issues have been resolved. So we should definitely try to run our business with these enactments. Whether it makes it easy or not, I do not know. But it is satisfactory in bringing about certainty to this. The most important aspect, which is also criticized, which is also appreciated, is the power of the government. So the government can tweet with the enactments, certain provisions as per the wish. The employees fear it will favor the employer. The employer is hopeful that based on the needs, it will be done to take care of the industry. After all, the industry or economy can run only with labor and capital being united. There cannot be a strife. I'm sure these codes will take to that direction, and it will bring industrial peace in the large extent in the days to come. Thank you so much.
Thank you, sir. It was really excellent, sir, from you. And it was just like a flow, and it was like a poetry when you were deliberating on the new code as such, sir. Today we have little more time. Maybe if we can have a couple of questions on the chat box, we can answer them. People who have questions up to the point, you can raise your hands. I will not open the persons who come in the name of your mobile. I should know who is coming. So the name should be there and who you are. Then only I can open the mic for you. So anyone willing to post a question, kindly raise your hands. Sir? I think,
yes.
Sir, Mr. Ratnavel Rajan of Ball Beverages Limited is joining us now. He also wanted to give off a felicitation. Maybe he was in a meeting. I think my father is also on the line. I'll try to unmute him if possible.
Yes.
Before Charumati?
Yes, ma'am.
Can you find out my father's name?
Yes, ma'am. Sure.
Yeah, he's there. He's there.
Yes.
Can he? Appa, can you unmute? I'll try to fix him, sir. I just posted him unmuting.
Yes, yes.
He has posted a message on the chat box. That's why I came to know.
Yes,
sir. Okay. Before I connect him, I'll unmute the other people. Deepak. Mr. Deepak. Please unmute.
Yeah, ma'am.
Mr. Deepak.
Good evening, ma'am. Hello.
Yes, good evening.
Good evening, sir. Sir, I have a question that in code on wages, central rules, there is a rule in rule 55.
Who is the online?
Deepak, ma'am. Deepak.
Yes, Deepak. Please be precise with your introduce yourself. You're from? You're an advocate or a HR?
I'm a HR professional.
Sir, there's somebody else speaking behind. Please ask them to be mute. I'll mute you. Okay, Mr. Venkatraman Kannan, please unmute yourself, sir. People who come, please don't have any background noise. We'll not be able to hear. Mr. Venkatraman Kannan, sir, please, your question.
Sir, good evening, Ravi, sir. Kannan here.
Good evening, Mr. Kannan.
The question is with regard to the gratuity, what will be the definition of wages? Because many companies, the basic and DA will put together something like 40%. So how the gratuity going forward would be computed?
See, a gratuity definition is on par with the definition in the IR code. Now, in all the four codes, it's simple. 50% basic and DA and retaining allowance are other allowances. As far as gratuity is concerned, law is settled, and this also here, only on basic and DA, nothing else. Yes.
So, the next one, Mr. Padmanabhan.
Yes.
Mr. Padmanabhan, please unmute.
Sir, good evening, sir.
Good evening.
So, thank you, madam. Nice session for both. Sir, I have a small doubt in this, sir. From 90s onwards, diploma and IT students, they are employed in private limited company for more than 5 years, 6 years, work on the time, like contract company. They are used as a casual labor, only on voucher payment salary. They don't get no other any benefit, ESI or PFO, the service for it. So, Andamari Alanga claims in the Mari issues, where they have to post it.
See, the Paray law in Siri, in the law in Siri, you are not covered in La Mila. Gratuity Valana, authority get a pono, ESA Valana, corporation get a pono, PF Valana, PF commissioner get a pono. That's all, there's no change. They are entitled earlier, now also.
So by going all these places, can we able to continue the employment in this concept, particular concept?
Hopefully.
Yes, sir.
Thank you.
Thank you, sir. Thank you, ma'am. Thank you.
Thank you, sir. நீங்க பேசுறவங்க நீங்க யாருன்னு அட்வொகேட்டா ஹெச்ஆரானு இன்ட்ரோடியூஸ் பண்ணிக்கோங்க so that people will know about you. Mr. Kannan and Padmanabhan.
Yes,
sir, I know Padmanabhan sir and Kannan sir, but others should know. Thank you. Thank you, Padmanabhan sir. Thank you. Mr. Surya, you can unmute. I hope.
Good evening, all of you, and thank you for this very, very valuable session. This is very informative, and the information shared by sir is very useful for us. Okay, basically, I am looking for compliances for one of the organization. I have one question related to minimum wages. We just now sir said that the minimum wages will be 50% of the gross. Okay, basic DA and HRA will be the 50%, and the rest of the components will be 50%. So this law, this will be applicable for the existing organizations, or when this enactment gets implemented, post that it will be applicable.
This explanation is applicable with immediate effect. Past is over. Now hereafter, when the government fixes minimum wages, this will be on par with this formula. So all the existing minimum wages will run its course, no doubt. But whenever the government fixes minimum wages henceforth, it will be based on the criteria fixed under the code on wages, which is likely to be more. Which is basic DA retailing of 50%, all other allowances another 50%. But even that basic DA retailing allowance is likely to be more because more components are added to it.
Okay, basically, I'm working in Mumbai. So now for Mumbai, the minimum wages revisions happen twice. Okay, for Jan to June and July to December.
Yes. Yes.
Okay, yeah. So now already we are nearing the December. Okay, so for example, if for a second, for an example, if I say that this gets implemented from January or January 2021 or 15 December 2020. So whatever the existing structure of my waste structure of my organization is, we need to change it according to the new provisions.
See, the new provision has laid down the principles. I suppose you are talking about minimum wages.
Overall wage structure
is concerned, the definition of wages has been revamped. Now, okay. Basic DA retaining allowance is included for various indirect benefits. All other allowances are excluded for various benefits, provided it is 50-50. So, there is no change in the wage structure. It can remain as it is, but the legal impact alone changes. For example, for gratuity, as the first question posed, what would be the salary criteria? Only basic DA and retaining allowance. ESA, basic DA and retaining. So all allowances are excluded hereafter for the purpose of contribution for bonus, ESA, Provident Fund, etc. But here, till now, there was a confusion which allowance should be included, etc. Now that has been clarified. As far as the fixation of wages between employer and employee is concerned, there is nothing changing in it.
Okay, suppose for example, drawing 20,000 gross, so 10,000 automatically will be basic DA and a retention allowance.
You are right.
Perfect. Okay, sir. Okay, sir. Thank you very much. Thank you for clearing my doubt.
Thank you.
Thank you, sir. May I now invite Mr. Ratnavel Rajan, the head HR of Bowl Beverages Limited, to unmute himself and offer his felicitations. Mr. Rajan.
Am I audible?
Yes.
Yeah. Sir, vanakkam, sir.
Vanakkam.
Rajan. It's always a pleasure and great honor to listen to you, sir.
No,
I'm in my village, so I'm not switching on my video because the bandwidth is very low. But I'm seeing your happy face. You always deal with any tough matters in the court of law also with your smiling face. Even only your opposition and the judges will be in the tensed, but you are always cool. So the same way in which you handle the session, putting forth all important points in a very, very simple manner, where in which even a layman like me also can understand and follow it. Thank you so much, sir, for continuing your service to the community of legal and the HR always. In a way, you are sharing all your thoughts in different forums. And thank you so much, sir, for your kind utterance.
Thank you. It's a pleasure.
And also, thank you, Alashmi Akka, for providing continuously these sessions, one-on-one, every week, every continuously. It's a great service, Akka, in this period. The new normal you adopted very well. Thank you so much.
Thank you so much, Rajan. My wishes to you. Thank you, sir. There is a message from my beloved father, Mr. K. Soundaraj, advocate and former HR head of CPCL, and also the former chairman of NIPM. He has posted in the chat, happy to see Dr. Maheshwari of Kolkata, Mr. Naresh Pinchetti of Pune, very senior HR professionals attending, elaborately explained in the limited time, compliment to Mr. Ravindran and the organizer, myself and my team. This is the message from my father, Mr. Soundaraj. We are sitting in the same home, but in the different rooms. I'm trying to connect him. He's on the Zoom meeting along with us. I'll try to unmute him, sir. In meantime, there are a few people who have risen hands. I'll open up. Mr. Yes. Rajendran Sriram, you can unmute yourself.
Good evening, madam.
Mr. And, Rajendran Sriram?
Yeah, I am on the line. Okay. Are you hearing? Audible? Hello?
Yes. Yes.
Sir, good evening,
yes, sir.
Yeah, thank you very much.
Yes, sir.
Yeah. Thank you very much, Adilakshmi Madam, for conducting a wonderful session, keeping the senior advocates and the time for us to understand the encoding the labor laws. Sir, my basic question is the coverage of ESAPF is still open or still it is need to any changes? No.
Same.
Like 21,000 for ESA and 15,000 for PF.
Yes.
Continue, correct?
For the present, yes.
Yeah. Thank you, sir. That's a doubt. Thank you very much, sir, for your kind enlightenment session.
Sir, kindly introduce yourself, whether you're a lawyer or you're from HR. So it'll be useful. Mr. Sharat Chandran, anyone else who's there, please raise your hands. Mr. Sharat Chandran, please go with your question, introducing yourself.
Yes, madam. Thank you, madam. So myself, Sarat Chandran, HR profession in a new greenfield company. Sir, good evening, sir.
Yes.
Your session was very enlightenment, very useful for me, sir. And one question there, sir. Our company is a new greenfield company. Whether the new code is applicable or earlier code is applicable for standing order other things, sir? Only one question.
See, yes, I understand. In fact, there is a clarification in the code itself. If you already have a certified standing orders, it will prevail and it will continue to be in operation. If you are not certified your standing orders, the new code will come into operation.
Actually, our parent company in Kolkata. So it is anyway connected or?
Yes.
Oh, okay. We can go with the new code. Right, sir?
See, no. I clarify. See, as far as standing orders concerned, it is not, applicability is not based on the company. It is not a company bylaw or company rules. It is for the establishment.
Okay.
So your company may be having 3 or 4 establishment. In each establishment, there must be a standing orders.
Yeah.
So if you are having standing orders already in force in certain establishment, and this new greenfield project, which is a new project, you don't have standing orders, you have to get it certified in terms of this act only.
Okay. Got it, sir. Thank you, sir.
Or the model which is prescribed. They are going to prescribe soon model. Yes.
Sir. Thank you, sir.
The existing standing order will prevail as it is
okay.
In your establishments.
Sir.
Yes, thank you.
Thank you, sir. There are a few more questions, sir, but the scheduled meeting time is